was believed in the potential of science as a liberator of the most oppressed people. Towards this end, he helped build the Madhya Pradesh Vigyan Sabha in the late 1980s to work with Adivasi indigenous populations in one of its most backward regions of the state. Experiments in the field led to the introduction of a low-cost water purification system, and social mobilization led to the local utilization of non-timber forest produce. Ajay was one of the key people involved in building Jan Swasthya Abhiyan after it was formed in 2001. He shouldered the major burden of the National Health Assembly in Bhopal in 2007. He also coordinated the Science National Secretariat of the Jan Swasthya Abhiyan, Asia Media, from Bhopal for 3 years. After that, we still find it so difficult to think of the JSA without Ajay. Without his infectious laughter and without his continuous and genuine effort to work across differences. As a leader of Madhya Pradesh Medical Officer Association, through his persistence, the Medical Officer Association became a thorn in the flesh of corrupt officers in the health department. He took on the evil project system, but never cynical. A part of him will live in all of us. Every year, Madhya Pradesh Jan Swasthya Abhiyan, we organize a memorial lecture in his memory. His work and commitments for the people's health movement in India continues to inspire us and give us strength.
We are going to put the tribute at the very end. Well, today is the last plenary session, and we are going to be talking about organizing and mobilizing for health for all struggles and resistances. And we have three very inspiring and interesting experiences from three corners of the world, from Europe, from Latin America, and from India. And I'm not going to go in any detail. They are going to be telling us all about their health. We will start with Alexis Venos from Greece.
Okay, so if everyone, every who is or she is involved in that, please contact me after the session. Because we want to raise also that in an international level. Anyway, now speaking about... yes, of course, I start. So, starting my talk, which is speaking about the struggles coming from the situation in Europe, and especially I'll take as an example to give you from Greece. Probably you know that Greece was in a way chosen as the experimental place to experiment with very rough, aggressive neoliberal policies by the European Union. So, yeah, okay. Yes? I'll okay. So, the neoliberal policies, which are unfortunately even today hegemonic in the European Union bureaucracy, which are mainly these policies of austerity and structural adjustment, which means more down. Okay? So, this was the. They have chosen the big case. Yeah, I'm sorry. I forgot to say that I'm going to speak in Greek for the interpretation. Okay, thank you very much. So, So you could say after that's one piece of the Anyway, so all these policies are produced by the greed of for-profit for the few, and we have an offensive. All these, of course, are international, but we have lived that in Greece. Offensive against labor, precariat, and all the dismantling of the labor conditions. Offensive against the welfare state and what that means, and the organization, the dismantling, but also, if we want to say, the values of welfare state, and of course, the dismantling and destruction of environment. So I'm going just to put these three issues that we have lived in Greece and how the movement reacted on that. So first of all, speaking about the crisis, you can see here what happened. I mean, the blue line is the GDP. So 2008, it was almost 250 billions of euros. And in 2013, it went down to 185. It's a big and abrupt fall of GDP. So the country generally was in poverty, okay? And the second very important issue is the rate of the unemployment, which from almost 7% went in 2013 to 28% of the population. That means regarding health, first of all, causes of the causes. So health was really damaged for the Greek population because of the crisis, because of working conditions, because of unemployment, because of poverty, because of bad nutrition, and so on and so on. So we have the causes of the causes producing health problems. That means the needs of the population for health care are raised, okay? But at the same time, the same policies are, the same policies are saying that dismantling health, and we are health service, and we are going to see that. So this was the first point. The second is, in this setting of crisis, we have the wave of refugees in Greece. These are very, last week's data, as you can see. Well, I want you to see that is very important. In 2015, we had 80,000, and if you add all that, it is 1 million of refugees in 2 years and a half. 1 million of refugees in a population accepting them of 11 million. Okay, so that it's not 1 million to hundreds of millions, it's just 11 million. So this produced, of course, another crisis, which we are going to speak about. And the implications of all of these policies are, as I said before, first of all, health, second, healthcare services, third, refugees, and then the environment. So, starting with the first, as we have seen already, we have a very high rate of unemployment, which means, as the Greek system of health services is a hybrid system between national health service but also social insurance scheme, so 28% of the working population didn't have any at all access to health care services because they were unemployed, so they lose their right in social insurance. So that means that the health problems produced by crisis and the unemployment produce a very big amount of the population which have needs for healthcare unmet by the system. And this was the first problem that we had to meet. And here is the solidarity movement which is coming. The state could not react to that, okay? So, or did not want, of course. So the solidarity movement is growing up, and it's very important, and it's growing quite early, from the 2010 to 11. The solidarity movement, which was brought the problem and the values of solidarity, especially organizing what we call social solidarity clinics. So today we have social solidarity clinics all over the country in the bigger cities, which are working as solidarity clinics, as we call them, replying to the needs that were produced by the destruction of the healthcare system by the austerity policies. So this is a picture, perhaps some of you have seen that in a two IPHUs that we have in Thessaloniki. This is the Social Solidarity Clinic in Thessaloniki, which is providing primary health cure services, dental services, and especially pharma. We are providing for free the drugs needed by the population. We are going to discuss all of that about social solidarity clinics in the next session outside in the lobby with Christina Kidona, who is one of the leading figures of this movement in Thessaloniki and in Greece also. So the idea, I mean, the motto, if we want to say, of all this movement of social solidarity clinics is that this, of course, really is Greek for you, but what it's saying is that we are going to make solidarity contagious. Okay? So it is a contagious disease, or not disease, of course, solidarity. And when we are speaking about solidarity, it's not only the health services, but also we have the movement, per se, organized solidarity kitchens, because a lot of people didn't have to eat. Solidarity gathering of clothes and of goods, of any kind of goods and of pharmacies, of course, in order to give to the people in need. Here, just a phrase about who did that. It was mainly local people, but also we had the refugees and immigrants that were there, which were also an important issue. So, another characteristic of this movement is that it was not only providing services, but also was making the demand for service loudly. So here you see we have a manifestation. This is a big university hospital, the entrance. And we have a manifestation of the Social Solidarity Clinic demanding the care, hospital care, for some people, for example, surgical operations and so on, for some people that did not have any insurance. So they were without papers, okay? So we were demanding, and we have succeeded to have that, we're demanding by the managers of the hospital to accept and make, give all the care that was needed because it was needed. So this was a very important and symbolical also, but also practical issue for the patient. In parallel, we have the solidarity movement, which is also very nice, in my view. We had also solidarity for all kinds of people working in arts. So we organized a lot of concerts and a lot of different cultural events, like expositions of from some painters and so on. All these artists were coming for free, of course, in solidarity, and the money gathered by these concerts and so on was going to the social solidarity clinics to cover the expenses needed for the functioning of these services. Of course, all the people working there are volunteers and solidarity people that they don't need to pay anything. So this movement also is part of the general movement. For example, here he's speaking about the environmental destruction produced by the extracting industry. So I'm going to this now, the environment. So we have the unfortunate is that in northern Greece, in Attiki, there is a site where there is an extracting industry which they want to extract gold. This industry is a multinational, of course, based in Canada and named El Dorado. Probably it is well known in Latin America also. Huh? So the place is quite nice. I mean, you are invited to see it before it is destructed. It is a very touristical place, actually, also. You can see a lot of nice seashore, but also a lot of nice mountains and nature. It's really a good place. It has also a lot of agriculture and farming activities, as it is one of the biggest producers of honey in Greece and so on. So this is the place that they wanted to destroy. So the idea is to destroy why? And this is very important also, I think it is international the same. They found, and this is assessment of the company, that there is density of gold is 1 gram per 1 ton of stone. So you have to destroy 1 ton in order to have 1 gram. So you understand that's nonsense. I mean, if you want to have 1 kilo, you have to destroy all the region. Okay? So it is nonsense in realistic terms. Of course, the answer is that all of this is just an exercise for the casino of the stock market, the international stock market exchange. Okay? Because their rates are going up. If they, the day that they're going to show the first gram of gold, of course, they're going to make big profits in the stock market, and perhaps after they're going to leave. And they're going to leave what? They're going to leave the destruction. You see here how it's starting, the 2012. In a few months, the destruction is starting. And of course, it is continuing. Here you have, you see all the trees under the police control, of course, more protection of cutting the trees, I mean, not protection of the trees. And you see there, and at the end, you see the pollution of the sea water, which is with acid water by the heavy metals, and was produced by a Marxist conspiracy, as Bolsonaro's saying, okay? Because it was a very big storm. Okay? And it was the big storm, and the climate change, of course, produced by this kind of destruction, is coming and is destroying this kind of destruction also, and producing the pollution and all the crisis, the local crisis. So the movement produced, first of all, locally, is very clear. There is no possibility, you know, to say, okay, exact industry, but we can have it controlling a bit and having some controls. There is no control. There is, we have to stop any extractive activity. Why? Because we know that the extractive activities are producing all over the world irreversible damage to nature. Irreversible, we cannot recover that. We cannot go back. Irreversible damage to the health of the humans. Irreversible damage to the local societies and communities, socially, economically, and culturally. So they are destroying everything. Irreversible. So if it is irreversible, we don't have to bargain. No, we don't want at all. So the local community, and that is very important, raised their voices. You see, all these are in the mountains, so are people living in the proximities, and trying to go and protest against the company, which is very well protected, as you can see, by policemen of the Greek state. So these policemen are paid by you and me and by these people, of course, to protect the interests of the Canadian multinational. So the movement is growing in locally, and then it's going on. You see on the right top, it is very important to say that the women movement also is leading that movement, which was very important for the local community, but also for all the national movements. And the movement is growing, and it's going to the next city, which is 60 kilometers, Thessaloniki, where I'm coming from. It's growing, it's a very big and interesting movement, trying to stop this. And of course, in this movement, that is what I said before, we have all parts of the movement. So here you can see the movement of the social solidarity clinics that is involved in this manifestation of the anti-extraction, because we are putting, the social solidarity are putting the issue of health as health first in the agenda. And in order to protect health, we have to stop this economic activity. Then we have the refugees. So here is last week news anyway, that we have you know, all these influx from Turkey to the Greek islands mainly. The majority of the refugees are Syrians, but they are not only from Syria. I mean, we have refugees from sub-Saharan and non-Saharan also places, all the Mediterranean, Africa, you know, where we had all the turmoils, Libya and so on. And the last years, we have also, which is important to say, refugees from Turkey. And these are political refugees, because you know that in Turkey we have a dictatorship. And actually, I take this opportunity to mention that here we had to have friends from Turkey, or comrades from Turkey, which could not come because the government took their passports. we almost have the same thing here, but anyway, in the frontier. But then they took their passports and they cannot travel. And not only that, they were fired by the jobs, university, hospitals, and so on. And some of them are on the trial with possibility to get in jail. So this is Turkey. So this is the problem of the refugees. Here I have to say, as I said before, in 2015, the problem of the refugees was that they were just passing through the country in order to go to their paradise of exploitation, Central and Western Europe. So they were really passing through. So the problem was addressed how you help some people that are passing through for a few days. So that's why the first welcome was, this is the way that they're coming, as you know, and that's why we have a lot of victims all over Mediterranean, of course. So this is the way that we host them, is to put them in refugees camps, which are really camps, not refugees. They are prisons, as you can see. And expecting that they are living, the living conditions are very bad, but hoping that they are going to live. Okay, so this was a big problem, a big issue. But unfortunately, as you know, at some moment, borders were closed, starting from Germany, Hungary, and so on, Austria, blah, blah, and coming to, this is the police of the Republic of Macedonia, and these are some refugees trying still to pass through, but without, of course, success. So, the refugees themselves begin to raise the issues and say, are we humans or not? Why are you acting like that to us? They are raising the, and questioning the problem of borders. Are there borders and why are there borders? Which is a global and international question, of course, for all of us. And the local people, and this is the important thing for us, is that, again, the local people started a solidarity movement for caring for the refugees. So this movement was quite successful in organizing, first of all, the food, the clothes, and all the needs, the immediate ones that they had, and gradually helped the integration of the refugees, the gradual integration, it's not finished, of course, the gradual integration of the refugees to the local society. And this is really a part of the movement. Here you see the people in the frontier, with Macedonia, that are expecting their fate anyway. But they are frustrated because they see that nothing is happening, of course, for them. So the movement is still going on. We are trying again, actually, to see, to make Fortress Europe a history, to finish with that. So it's a European issue, it's not only Greek, of course. And we have to see that, because the other European countries don't, I mean, especially in the north. In Italy, in Spain, we have movements because they have the same problem, but the other countries, they don't care. And of course, we have the optimistic view of the young generation of people possibly born during this trip, and which are, as you see in the faces, are looking at the future optimistically. So this issue produced also quite a big activity by artists. We have a lot of very nice films, as this one, documentaries, speaking and working with this issue. And the movement is going on. Here is a call for a demonstration, calling for papers for everyone. Papers means legality papers for the asylum seekers, for all the refugees that are non-paper people. So, concluding, we have these three cases of solidarity movements. Why we are speaking about that? Of course, first of all, the important issue that we have lived is that these solidarity movements are spontaneous but very important collective response to the emerging needs. So we didn't let anyone to his problem and say, okay, this is your problem, selfish problem. No, it is a common problem, it is a social problem, so we have to deal with that as a society. So as a solidarity movement. This is the first value, let's say. The second is all the anti-fascist values that this movement produced. Because as you can imagine, for all these cases, the fascist groups are getting involved, especially for the refugees. You can understand that, to say, okay, all these bloody foreigners, what they're doing here, and they are taking our services and so on. So this movement stopped the fascist rhetoric and say that no, we are a human society, we have to live as humans, and we have this, the only way to do that is solidarity. And the last one, which is very important for us, but not only for us, speaking for me because I'm quite old, but for the young generation, is that all this movement is building a certain grassroots movement, memories and bonds, which means that all the people that are in this movement have a wealth of experience now, but also of feelings for the future. That is saying to them that if we are working together, if we are discussing together, as we are doing here, if we are deciding together, as we are doing here, and if we are acting together, then we can change the world. So, you see here, it is a woman of the movement, anti-gold movement, but this woman could be in Cochabamba, no, or wherever in the world. She is one of the anonymous leaders of the movement. And this is the idea that we have, I mean, the movement has a wealth of cultural, of political, of ideological, but also effective steps that we have to keep on thinking. And speaking about movement, this is the anti-fascist manifestation 2 days ago that was in Thessaloniki, which was a big manifestation, as we learned, and that's why I found this picture by the internet to show you that the movement is going on. So the idea is that the movement is going on. As we said before, when we are united, we cannot be stopped. Or we can say it in another way. Pueblo unido jamás será vencido. Pueblo unido jamás será vencido. Pueblo unido jamás será vencido. Gracias.
Realities of the neoliberal assault on Europe, which maybe it's less known, but it's not less important than what is happening in other continents. The next presentation is from Román Vega. Román Vega is an active member of PHM Colombia and ALAMES. He is a medical doctor and a surgeon by Universidad Nacional de Colombia. He has an MA in Health Administration and Social Security and a PhD on health policies and administration by Hull University. He's a professor at postgrad and master's studies and at PhD on social science at Bogota. He's a former health secretary at the Bogota municipality, and all his life he has been a political and a social activist. He's going to talk to us about the experiences of reorganizing and rebuilding health in rural areas after the savage conflict in Colombia, which in reality is still almost gone. It's over to you.
Is he speaking in Spanish?
He is going to speak in Spanish, yeah. Yeah. Use the headphones, he's going to speak in Spanish, so you will need translation.
Buenos días. Ya han cambiado a inglés la traducción para los que quieran escuchar en inglés, etc. En primer lugar, quiero agradecer a David Sanders, a Amit Sengupta, a Annelien, a Kiara por habernos facilitado usar recursos de un proyecto de investigación denominado Contribución de la Sociedad Civil a la Salud para Todos. En este proceso que está llevando a cabo el Movimiento para la Salud de los Pueblos en un territorio de nuestro país, de Colombia. Voy a hablar de las posibilidades que tenemos de trabajar por cambios en salud. Una vez se ha producido un acuerdo de paz entre la guerrilla más grande de nuestro país y más vieja y el gobierno nacional. Lo que voy a hacer es una especie de pintar qué es el territorio, cómo es que estamos trabajando en él y cuáles son las posibilidades para el futuro en un escenario de postconflicto en Colombia. Esta es una representación hecha por un campesino dirigente del territorio de la Macarena sobre lo que es esta hermosa región. Allí convergen las montañas de la cordillera de los Andes, la Amazonía y los llanos de la Orinoquía de Sudamérica. Es un territorio estratégico por su riqueza en biodiversidad, en agua, en bosques, clave para la sobrevivencia de la especie humana en términos de los desafíos que tenemos frente al cambio climático. Allí trabajamos con una población de 20.000 personas asentadas en 127 veredas, es decir, village. En inglés no encontré una adecuada traducción de la palabra vereda. Son alrededor de 9.930 familias organizadas en asociaciones de juntas comunales por village y en asociaciones de estas juntas a través de tres grandes organizaciones campesinas del territorio, de organizaciones de mujeres y de organizaciones de indígenas. Allí también se asienta un espacio en el cual los guerrilleros, los ex guerrilleros, hacen tránsito a la vida civil, acompañados por distintas instituciones del gobierno y por la población. Este es un territorio que, como ustedes ven, tiene una población enormemente dispersa, generalmente 3 habitantes por kilómetro cuadrado. A este territorio llegaron los indígenas y los campesinos perseguidos por la violencia en Colombia. Hay que recordar que Colombia es uno de los países más desiguales del mundo en términos de la distribución de la propiedad de la tierra. Tenemos un Gini de 0.9, lo cual ha hecho que los campesinos hayan tenido que luchar muy fuertemente por la posesión, la propiedad de la tierra, pero el tiempo hayan sido perseguidos por los terratenientes, por las Fuerzas Armadas del Estado y por grupos paramilitares. En esa persecución llegaron al territorio en los años 50, cuando la violencia en Colombia se acrecentó luego de la muerte de Jorge Eliécer Gaitán, uno de los líderes populares más importantes que ha tenido el país en su historia. Para sobrevivir, los campesinos tuvieron que organizarse en autodefensas campesinas pacíficas. Se asentaron en el territorio. El gobierno de la época declaró que habían constituido repúblicas independientes y que como tal deberían ser atacados por las Fuerzas Armadas. En 1964 el gobierno
agredió a la región con las Fuerzas Armadas a través de lo que se denominó el Plan Lazo, Latin American Security Operation, organizado por los Estados Unidos, conjuntamente con el gobierno de nuestro país. Como consecuencia de la arremetida militar en el territorio, los campesinos tuvieron que transformarse de autodefensas campesinas en una organización guerrillera. Allí surgió las FARC-EP, es decir, las Fuerzas Armadas Revolucionarias de Colombia, Ejército del Pueblo. Esa organización guerrillera se extendió a todo el territorio nacional, junto con otras organizaciones, como una forma de resistencia armada a la violencia y a la agresión de las fuerzas oficiales. Como consecuencia de esa guerra, Colombia ha tenido más de 7 millones de refugiados internos y más de 300.000 muertos y varias decenas de miles de desaparecidos. Como ven, esas son las fotos de la época de 1964. El gobierno, las Fuerzas Armadas desembarcan en el territorio para atacar a los campesinos indefensos. Los campesinos resistieron y se constituyeron en un movimiento guerrillero. Son las fotos clásicas de la historia del surgimiento de la guerrilla campesina en nuestro país. En ese contexto, la salud, ¿qué papel jugó y qué papel ha jugado? Es la pregunta. Lo primero que tenemos que decir es que este es un territorio donde no hay salud, no hay sistema de salud. El Sistema General de Seguridad Social en Salud que describió ayer Mauricio Torres no funciona en este territorio. No funciona porque no es rentable económicamente y porque el Estado no asigna recursos públicos para que el sistema como tal funcione. Las guerrillas organizaron desde 1993 un sistema propio de salud y de atención en salud, con clínicas clandestinas y con personal guerrillero, muchos de ellos jóvenes, mujeres y hombres analfabetas, entrenados para atender sus heridos, para tratarlos, pero también para atender a la población donde se movían como organización guerrillera. Del mismo modo, las Fuerzas Armadas oficiales organizaron su estrategia de acción a través de lo que se denominan brigadas cívico-militares, con las cuales buscaban atender a la población esporádicamente para vigilarla y para hacer inteligencia sobre la presencia de las fuerzas guerrilleras en el territorio. En el proceso de la guerra, las Fuerzas Armadas de Colombia, los grupos paramilitares organizados por el gobierno y por los terratenientes, impusieron una serie de medidas que fueron una violación al derecho a la salud. Entre ellas, el bloqueo de acceso de medicamentos a la población civil, el bloqueo de ingreso de alimentos. En esas circunstancias, enfermedades como el paludismo, la leishmaniasis, no podían ser tratadas ni para los guerrilleros, pero tampoco para los campesinos habitantes del territorio. Introdujeron, cuando capturaban heridos de las guerrillas, microchips en sus cuerpos o en los alimentos que la población campesina entregaba a los guerrilleros para hacer ataques teledirigidos a los campamentos de las guerrillas. Pero también usaron armas biológicas contra las concentraciones de guerrilleros y bloquearon las tareas de la misión médica cuando quiera que ella hubiese podido ser realizada. El 24 de noviembre del 2016 se firmó un acuerdo de paz entre las FARC y el gobierno nacional, del cual derivaron distintos componentes, entre ellos el acuerdo de hacer una distribución de la tierra y de entregar títulos de propiedad a los campesinos y a las poblaciones indígenas, y de crear condiciones de todo tipo para la producción, pero también para el buen vivir de las comunidades del campo. Entre las medidas acordadas estuvieron las de desarrollar planes nacionales de desarrollo diseñados desde el gobierno nacional y planes territoriales de desarrollo diseñados con la participación de las comunidades en diversos campos. Entre esos planes estuvo un plan nacional de salud rural que buscaba reconstruir la infraestructura, el equipamiento y dotar de recurso humano a las instalaciones de salud del territorio para la atención de la población campesina. Desarrollar un modelo especial de salud pública para, lo, como dice el gobierno, las zonas rurales dispersas, bajo un enfoque diferencial y de género. Se ubicaron 177 territorios. 177 territorios que indican, que indican parte de la extensión del dominio, de algún modo territorial, de la guerrilla en el territorio. Uno de esos territorios fue este que estoy indicando, La Macarena, el cual ya señalé, en el corazón de Colombia. Allí surgieron las Fuerzas Armadas Revolucionarias y tuvieron su comando general y diseñaron todas las estrategias de guerra en nuestro país. Nosotros, el Movimiento para la Salud de los Pueblos, decidimos, junto con una red de universidades comprometidas con la salud y la paz de Colombia, hacer un proceso de intervención en ese territorio. Comenzamos en el año 2017, en junio, en una interacción con las comunidades campesinas, como ustedes pueden observar, tratando de entender la situación de salud, las necesidades y las expectativas de ellas frente a su futuro en materia de implementación del Plan Nacional de Salud Rural. Pudimos identificar sus experiencias de lucha en materia de crear condiciones para mejorar su calidad de vida y de atención en salud. Identificamos sus necesidades y problemáticas de salud. Igualmente, identificamos las propuestas de solución que las comunidades nos mostraban serían las que ellos creerían adecuadas. Hicimos compromisos generales. Aquí ustedes pueden observar esta reunión en la que están los dirigentes de las organizaciones campesinas y de las comunidades indígenas, y esta otra en la que están los excombatientes guerrilleros en uno de los campamentos de reincorporación a la vida civil. Con todos ellos llegamos a acuerdos sobre lo que debería hacerse en el territorio. En concreto, nos comprometimos a ayudarles a definir un camino para la participación en la formulación del plan de salud del territorio, lo cual requería hacer un estudio, un censo de salud para analizar la situación de salud, una cartografía social para ubicar los territorios de salud y unos talleres que están en proceso de formulación para diseñar el plan territorial de salud. Al mismo tiempo nos comprometimos a ayudarles a organizar los comités de salud de las organizaciones comunitarias de cada village o de cada vereda, como decimos en nuestro lenguaje. Coordinar las organizaciones para la movilización, para la abogacía ante las instituciones públicas, e igualmente generar un proceso de construcción de capacidades. David, eso es el resultado de la investigación que realizamos sobre contribución de la sociedad civil a la salud para todos. Ahí mostramos rápidamente cómo hemos venido trabajando con las comunidades en la cartografía social, en el diseño de los cuestionarios para la realización del censo de salud que los mismos campesinos aplican en el territorio. Aquí mostramos el avance que hemos tenido en la terminación del censo de salud. Realmente estamos a una semana de cerrar el proceso. Y aquí, ¿cómo hicimos la organización de los comités de salud y la generación de capacidades con los mismos? Creados los comités de salud, nos fuimos con ellos a 5 puntos estratégicos del territorio, donde había 5 puestos de salud en condiciones tan precarias como estas que ustedes pueden ver, cerrados, destruidas sus ventanas y paredes, sin equipamiento ninguno. Diseñamos con ellos cómo era el territorio de salud en términos de las distancias en motocicleta para llegar a este punto y en términos de la cantidad de familias por cada village en el territorio. Ese proceso lo realizamos con cada uno de los puntos donde encontramos puestos de salud. Este puesto de salud, por ejemplo, fue construido por la guerrilla y por la Cruz Roja Internacional en un sitio donde la guerrilla tuvo sus campamentos en el momento más crudo de la lucha guerrillera en nuestro país. También lo hicimos en otros puntos, un poco en mejores condiciones. Aquí nos reunimos con familias indígenas. Este es una maloca, es decir, un sitio de reunión de los indígenas, y con ellos identificamos las problemáticas de salud del territorio. Igualmente con las demás organizaciones, territorios del escenario en el que estábamos trabajando. Si uno quisiera identificar qué es lo que es el sistema de salud de Colombia que ayer planteó Mauricio, podría decir, es un sistema donde no hay salud pública. Si ustedes ven, este es uno de los colegios en una de las veredas, y en este colegio esta mujer que trabaja en la cocina con una estufa tiene una pipeta de gas y además con un escape. Este es el colegio. No hay ninguna cultura en el territorio sobre seguridad en materia de salud. Pero no solo no hay cultura en ese aspecto. Estos son recipientes de agua descubiertos, criaderos de larvas, de mosquitos, del paludismo, del chikungunya, del zika, del dengue. Y este es el estado del puesto de salud en el cual se supone que debería desarrollarse una actividad de programas de salud pública para preservar la salud de la comunidad. Lo que el gobierno hace es encomendarle a una persona ir casa a casa al territorio con un formulario para hacer educación en salud y entregar ese como el producto de lo que sería el trabajo en salud pública en el territorio. Si ustedes ven lo que es salud pública, también pueden mirar lo que es la atención individual en salud. Este es el pene de un niño de 10 años. Hace 6 meses tiene una verruga que le sale por el meato urinario, probablemente fruto de un virus de papiloma humano. Y no ha sido posible que las aseguradoras privadas lo atiendan, ni en el territorio ni fuera de él. Aquí nos fuimos entonces a discutir con la dirección del hospital del municipio. ¿Qué hacer frente a las circunstancias del territorio? Respuesta: no hay recursos, no tenemos capacidad de decisión, no hay plata, no hay dinero para actuar en el territorio. Avanzamos en la idea de ayudar a las comunidades a resolver sus problemas y decidimos hacer un entrenamiento de trabajadores comunitarios de salud, montar una campaña de reapertura de los puestos de salud, de vincular a médicos del mundo para que asuma tareas que debe hacer el Estado colombiano y de formular el Plan Territorial de Salud. Aquí vemos el trabajo que hemos hecho de entrenamiento de los trabajadores comunitarios de salud en varios sitios del territorio. En este momento ese proceso está siendo desarrollado allí. Aquí vemos los acuerdos de médicos del mundo con las organizaciones campesinas para ir al territorio a cumplir 3 tareas. Primera, entrenamiento de trabajadores comunitarios. Segundo, atención en salud. Tercero, participar del proceso de formulación del plan de salud del territorio. Obviamente queremos generar una experiencia distinta a la experiencia del conjunto de la situación de salud en las poblaciones rurales de Colombia. Lo que he mostrado es lo que pasa en general en la ruralidad colombiana. No es una excepción, es un ejemplo de lo que encontramos en diversos territorios del país. Hemos logrado incluir en la discusión de los planes de desarrollo con enfoque territorial las propuestas de las comunidades. E igualmente, en este escenario, que es donde están concentrados los exguerrilleros, con la presencia de la gobernadora de la provincia, hemos hecho acuerdos de crear una mesa conjunta, gobierno, comunidades, universidades, para formular un plan piloto de salud en el territorio que sea ejemplo para la implementación de la paz, de las propuestas de salud de paz en el conjunto del país. Esta es la reunión con el Ministerio de Salud del país, que a pesar de estar en manos de un presidente conservador, ha dicho: discutamos a ver qué podemos hacer. Y estos son los desafíos, y con esto termino. Pensamos que es posible, con las comunidades, construir un sistema público de salud en el territorio. El sistema de aseguramiento en Colombia no tiene alternativa distinta en las zonas rurales dispersas. Razón: la economía de la salud nos dice, el mercado no funciona en los territorios rurales. Pero tenemos otros desafíos. Obviamente, luchar contra la mercantilización del sistema. El 85% de la población campesina rural está afiliada al Sistema General de Seguridad Social, pero no hay servicios. Tenemos que luchar contra eso. No hay una política de construcción clara de distritos de salud, de territorios de salud, que permita concentrar los esfuerzos. Tampoco hay una adecuada asignación de recursos públicos, financieros, humanos, técnicos, para la atención en salud en el territorio. Las debilidades de las instituciones públicas son notorias y hay que reconstruir la institucionalidad pública destruida por el sistema de salud. La prevalencia del modelo biomédico es un obstáculo para poner en práctica la atención primaria en salud, que es la única estrategia que puede funcionar en territorios en estas condiciones. Y la exclusión de los saberes tradicionales, populares y de las comunidades indígenas es otro de los desafíos. Creemos que la interculturalidad es clave para lograr avanzar en el territorio. No vamos a hacer el cambio del conjunto del sistema de salud con estas iniciativas, pero vamos a iniciar un proceso de movilización campesina, de colocar en la agenda de lucha de los campesinos de Colombia la bandera del derecho a la salud digna para todos y para todas. Mil gracias.
Roman, for the very interesting presentation. I think it will be very interesting to hear in the next PHM assembly how this initiative is taking place and it's maybe shaping other initiatives in Colombia. And our next and last speaker is Shulakshana Nandi from India. She's a joint convener of JSA or PHM India. She works in Chhattisgarh with women's organizations and organizations of indigenous communities on the right to health, food, forest rights, and gender justice. She's also a researcher, and she's involved in struggles against privatization of healthcare. She's going to be talking about the struggles on health forums in Chhattisgarh.
Sabiko Zindabad. I am going to talk about some of the struggles that has happened in Chhattisgarh. Chhattisgarh is a state in India which has a large indigenous population. And as with all such areas, it's very rich in minerals. And so there's a proliferation of extractive industries. There's a lot of repression of the state and currently, as we speak, a very close comrade, a human rights lawyer, Sudha Bhardwaj, is in jail. Along with that, parts of the state are embroiled in conflict between Maoists and the state, and it's the people who are getting but I will not be speaking on these issues, and I will be speaking, on some other struggles that have been done by Jan Swasthya Abhiyan Chhattisgarh, the Right to Food campaign in Chhattisgarh, the Adivasi Adhikar Samiti, which is a women's organization of indigenous women, and the Mithalins, who are community health workers and who actually are at the forefront of leading the health rights struggle in the state. And a thank you to Nilanjana for developing a small video that I'm going to be showing later on. So I'm going to be covering the struggles for over rights over forests, over the right to food, on reproductive health rights of vulnerable communities, and against healthcare privatization. I would be alluding to some strategies, that we have followed in many of our struggles in order to sort of try and develop also a common understanding and share some of the learnings from our experiences. In 2007, in Korea district, where I was living at that point of time, the government itself started felling a huge number of trees, and the community health workers of that village, the Mithalins, saw that and they did not could not understand what was happening, but they actually went after a week of felling. They went and snatched all the axes and the saws from the people who were cutting the trees, and they got it and they went to the police station and deposited them. There was a lot of police cases that were put on the Mithanins and the other leaders of the women's organization Adivasi Adhikar Samiti, but they continued the struggle because they said that the forests are our lives, and this is an area which has very rich mixed forests, and they said the forest is our lives, and the forests go where will our health go, and where will our lives go. So the struggle went on to the streets, and they had demonstrations, and it spread throughout the district wherever the government was cutting the trees. The government was to cut around 20 million trees in order to do plantations of alien species. So the government looks at forests as an economic entity, and you know, production forestry is a term that is used, and which is completely out of line with what the indigenous people believe in and in their linkage with the forest. So the struggle continued, and they also filed a public interest litigation in the High Court, which they won, and finally the felling project was disbanded, and they managed to save around 20 million trees around their villages. And but this struggle continued. I mean, I think that's something that we always realize, that you know, even if you get a victory, and but it continues. The